good evening, Christchurch, and good evening to all our guests as you join us this Easter Sunday evening to celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Here are some words that Jesus said before his death and resurrection. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Jesus also said, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep." And Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" Well, all who are weary or burdened, all who are struggling or suffering or anxious or lonely or even sick, even contemplating death itself, are invited to come this evening to Jesus. We invite you to come to Jesus with us and to give him glory as God's Son, the one who rose and conquered. We're going to do that together now. We invite you to stand and sing along with us as we sing, "Thine Be the Glory." Let us pray together. Lord God, we praise and glorify your name, for you are the God who has come down to rescue us, your people. We thank you that in the Lord Jesus we can know forgiveness of our sins and new life. Thank you that we are raised up with him and seated with him, with you, so that we might know and be assured that our sins are forgiven and that we have life everlasting in Jesus. Lord, we bring you glory in his name and ask for your help as we look more into your word this evening. In Jesus' name, amen. Just one or two reminders of things. If you're part of the church family at Christchurch Banstead, you should receive a weekly email if you regularly attend a service with us. That'll tell you everything you need to know about what's going on or not going on, as the case may be, at the moment. A reminder for YP2, your group isn't meeting tonight, so there's no meeting on Zoom this evening, but you'll be back doing that next Sunday evening. Do keep an eye on our website and social media pages for any updates and resources. We're adding to those all the time, and we hope they can be an encouragement to you in these days. Well, the rest of the service is going to run unannounced. In a moment, it'll be time for our Spotlight series. Andrew and Eleanor are going to take us through the next instalment of that, as we've been listening to different members of our congregation, seeing how they've been surviving the lockdown and what's been encouraging them and others they've been speaking to from God's word. After that, we'll be have an opportunity to sing again. Then James will lead us in prayer, and Daniel will come to read and proclaim the good news of Jesus' resurrection to us. So it's time for Spotlight now with Andrew and first Eleanor.
Everybody, it's really strange, isn't it, that we're meeting on this special resurrection day, this special Sunday, and we're not together. I think it's the first time that that's ever happened, and it just reminds me of the our persecuted brothers and sisters, who actually every Easter Sunday is like that for them. They're often isolated, a fear of arrest and betrayal, and it was a really good reminder. Anyway, so how are we managing in lockdown? Well, we're missing many of the things that I guess we're all missing: our friends, our church family, our children, our grandchildren. And actually seeing and chatting to our grandchildren on WhatsApp isn't quite the same as giving them a big hug, but anyway, that's it, what it is for the time being. And actually our routines change, because a couple of days a week we have been looking after our grandchildren, which of course we can't do at the moment. So we're just thinking and trying to work out new routines, which include physical exercise every day, trying to get spiritual nourishment, and also keeping that social contact, although at a distance. So here are some of the things that we do in our day. We always get up early, before 7 o'clock, and we go out for our daily walk. And we've just had some lovely walks just from our house. It's lovely sunny weather, and that's been a great blessing to us. Also, as our life is not quite so hectic now, there's actually no excuse for us not being able to find time to read our Bibles and to pray. And what I've been reading is this book, To Seek and to Save. It's the Daily Reflections on the Road to the Cross. It's Luke's account of Jesus' last journey to Jerusalem and some of the encounters, the people that he met. And what I've been challenged by is Jesus' steadfast determination to go where he knew he would face opposition, betrayal, arrest, and be completely isolated, cut off from Father God. And he did this out of love for me, so that I wouldn't need to be isolated, but with him, from him, forever. And this has helped me to really put this present situation of isolation and lockdown into an eternal perspective.
I have always found that the Lord has fed, guided, encouraged, challenged, and corrected me on a day-by-day basis by bringing to my mind particular verses or passages of Scripture. The house where I was born and brought up was called Cherith. So when the lockdown first started, and because of our age and health, we weren't supposed to do our own shopping, my mind immediately went back to 1 Kings chapter 17, where God hid the prophet Elijah from Ahab's wrath by the brook Cherith, and the ravens brought him bread and meat both morning and evening. The Lord has provided for us not only a Cherith, but also ravens in the shape of Lane, Lisa, our daughter Lizzie, and even our 18-month-old granddaughter, who carries the provisions up the garden path and places them on the front steps one at a time whilst we wave to her from inside. Even this fleeting opportunity to see her, I see as the Lord's provision. Yet there is more in this passage. The brook Cherith dried up because of the very drought that Elijah had prophesied and that had caused Ahab to be so angry with him. But that was not a problem for the Lord. He simply moved Elijah on to his next provision for him. Read it again in 1 Kings 17, verses 8 to the end of that chapter. It speaks volumes to me. He has provided for me now at Cherith, and I can be sure from my own experience and from what I read in this chapter that he will go on not only providing for us, but also using us to bring blessing to other people. We can rely on him.
A significant part of our day has also been, or my day, has been to make phone calls to keep in touch, particularly with the more senior members of our congregation. And actually this has been a great blessing and a benefit, as we've been able to encourage one another and deepen our friendships, albeit over the phone. The other thing that we're trying to do in New Horizons is each week to write a contact sheet, or keeping in contact. And what we're doing is choosing a psalm, or this week an Easter reflection, and just a short reflection on it, a traditional hymn, and also what we all love, a quiz. And we send this out to all the members of our New Horizons group, to just so that we can keep in contact with each other. And last week the psalm was 62, and these are the two verses that particularly struck me. My salvation and my honour depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge. I just find that this is a timely reminder that the only safe and certain, or truly safe and certain place, is not my earthly home, but trusting in God, my rock, so that I can be safe, dwelling in him now and for eternity. Thank you. Matters for prayer. We're just thankful for the kindness of our family and our church family in doing our shopping and collecting our prescriptions. But just ask for prayer that we would use our time wisely, making most of the opportunities to serve not ourselves, but to serve the Lord. That we would continue to count our many blessings, including this lovely fine weather. We've got homes, we have the blessing of a garden, which has been great. That our family, and actually our wider family, would keep strong in their faith, and the more vulnerable members in particular would be kept physically safe and spiritually safe in God our refuge, and God their refuge. And I guess, as I mentioned at the beginning, I've been really thinking about the persecuted church, and prayer really for us that we'd have greater insight into the situation of our brothers and sisters who live in lands where they're not free to worship, and that's significant all the time, they're isolated.
When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, our all-knowing, ever-present, perfectly just and perfectly compassionate Father God. In this virus-ridden and anxious world, it is all too easy to wonder where you are. In our fears of the suffering brought on by COVID-19, it is all too easy to look more to our health service than to you. In a country in which we are surrounded by unbelievers, it is all too easy to drift away ourselves. Help us to understand that you are still God. Help us to remember that you're the same God who sent Jesus to die for us and brought him back to life. Help us to know that you stay true to your promises and will never let us go. We pray that you will set our eyes on eternal things, our priorities on holiness,
and our plans on things that please you. We pray that you will ever more passionately, that we will ever more passionately desire you, and that we may consider all other things trivial and meaningless by comparison. We are truly sorry for putting other things before you. We are sorry for deliberately thinking, saying and doing things which displease you. Help us to deal with them. Convict us of those sins which we may not recognise as sins, and help us to deal with them also. Help us to become each day a little more like Jesus Christ. And as you forgive us, let us forgive those who have done wrong to us, and release us from any sense of bitterness or bad feeling. Let us be kind and compassionate to one another, and a forgiving, peace-loving, peace-seeking people. We pray for our Pastor Kevin and his ministry team, and for all others in churches across the world who have devoted their lives to full-time biblical ministry. We thank you for the truth that they teach us, for the example that they set us, and we pray that you'll grant them wisdom. We pray also that they may grow in their faith and that you will provide for their needs. And we pray that you will help them through the different challenges and trials that they each may be facing right now. Help us within their churches to provide them with support and encouragement and to make their ministries a joy. We pray too for missionaries. We pray that you will keep them safe, often in places far from their home countries and in challenging circumstances. We pray that they may know your will for them. And now we turn to those in our church family or listening into this service, or who we know who are struggling. We pray for those who are anxious, for those who are sick, for those who are lonely, for those who are grieving, for those with financial worries, for those who are looking after their parents, for those who are struggling with homeschooling, for those who are looking after the sick, for those with too much work, and for those with too little work, for those struggling to live in cramped, lockdown conditions, for those who are having difficulty coping with their burdens, in whatever other form that they may take. Lord God, we lift each one to your tender, loving care. Finally, we thank you on this Easter Sunday for Jesus Christ, for allowing him to die so that we can be forgiven, and for his resurrection. Let him be the cornerstone of our church, of our faith, and of our lives. By the power of the Holy Spirit, and the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, good evening and happy Easter. In case we haven't met before, my name is Daniel, and I'm the assistant minister here at ChristChurch Banstead. I'm very much looking forward to going back to our church building in the future and being able to meet with people face to face again. So if you do come to our church in the future, to our church building, when by God's grace we are able to meet there again, and if you see me, please do come and tap me on the shoulder and say hi. It would be great to meet you. Tonight we are looking at John chapter 20, verses 11 to 31. So what I'll do is I'm going to read the passage for us, and then I'll pray, and then we'll think about the passage together. So why don't you turn with me to John chapter 20. John chapter 20, and we're looking at verses 11 to 31. So, verse 11. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? They have taken my Lord away, she said, and I don't know where they have put him. At this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there. But she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for? Thinking he was the gardener, she said, Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him. Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means teacher. Jesus said, Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, I have seen the Lord. And she told them that he had said these things to her. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, Peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again Jesus said, Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with that he breathed on them and said, Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, We have seen the Lord. But he said to them, Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, Peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Thomas said to him, My Lord and my God. Then Jesus told him, Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. Allow me to pray for us. Father, we thank you so much for the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for preserving this evidence for us. Help us now as we think about it together. Father, we pray that this would give us great confidence in the resurrection as we read this story and the confidence of the resurrection of Christ. And Father, we pray that if there are any who do not currently believe in the Lord Jesus' resurrection, we pray that this passage would help them to see how it is an event that happened in history by the power of your Spirit. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, given that it's Easter Sunday and given the passage we've just read, it's not very hard for you to guess what I'm going to be talking about this evening. It is, of course, Jesus's resurrection. Now, some of us might wonder, why do we need to hear yet another talk about Jesus's resurrection? Some of us have indeed been to many Easter Sunday services over the years, and so we know the drill. And we might think, do you know what? I'm familiar with Jesus' resurrection. Uh, I've heard about it many times, so I'm not sure this talk's really going to help me, but I'm sure it's really helpful for the non-Christian who might be tuning in. So I'm glad we're doing it, but maybe it's not that important for me. However, if you're not a Christian, you might be thinking, oh, why do Christians always talk about Jesus's resurrection on Easter Sunday? Oh, perhaps they just do it because that's their tradition. They're used to doing it, so they just keep on doing it. Now, I want to tell you why I am preaching about Jesus's resurrection today. Now, there are a few reasons. One of them being that my boss asked me to do it. And so Kevin asked me to do it, so I should do it. Generally, you should do what your boss asks you to do. If you're not sure about that, go back and listen to our series on work. But rest assured that that is not the only reason I'm preaching on Jesus's resurrection today. I'm very glad to be preaching about it. And I want to, and I believe it is important. So if you're not a Christian, indeed, it is very important for you to hear about Jesus' resurrection. Christianity rises or falls on its historicity. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, then you shouldn't really become a Christian. There's no point, really. But if he did rise from the dead, then you really should become a Christian, as I hope I will see later. The second reason I'm preaching on Jesus' resurrection this evening is because it is vitally important for Christians. If you're a Christian, you need to be reminded that Jesus rose from the dead. Not only because it's one of the most foundational beliefs of Christianity, but because I think it can turbocharge our faith. Now, what do I mean by that? Sometimes our faith can go through peaks and troughs. And intentionally reminding ourselves that Jesus rose from the dead can be a real encouragement to help us keep going as Christians, to keep trusting in the Lord. So, for example, when I'm tempted to doubt whether it's worthwhile living for Christ, I remind myself, Jesus rose from the dead. I'm not living in light of something I hope to be true, but in light of something I know to be true, an actual historical event. And that spurs me on to keep going. Excuse me. So how can we be sure that Jesus rose from the dead? That's the question we're thinking about tonight. If you've ever asked yourself, isn't believing that Jesus rose from the dead just wishful thinking? Then I hope tonight's passage will help to answer that. So how can we be sure that Jesus rose from the dead? We can be sure because people witnessed it. Our first point is, Mary saw the risen Jesus. Our passage begins with Mary at Jesus' empty tomb. Now, this is Mary, Jesus' friend, not Mary, Jesus' mother. So she's there, and she's trying to make sense of the whole situation. Look at me at verse 11. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there. But she did not realize that it was Jesus. Now, this is the second time Mary has looked into the tomb. And Jesus' body is definitely not there. Her mind is not playing tricks on her. This time, though, she encounters two angels there who ask her why she's crying. a question Jesus asks her as well. So look at me at verse 15. Jesus asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Why is she being asked why she's crying? Because she has no need to cry. Jesus is right there with her. But she mistakes him for the gardener. Now at this point, we might be tempted to think, oh, wait, maybe it wasn't Jesus she saw, or else she would have recognized him. But I would suggest that she doesn't recognize him so far because she knows, like most sane people do, that dead people stay dead. She's not looking to find Jesus strolling about, is she? She's looking to find his dead body. And so she asks the gardener to help her find him. And he does help her, but not in the way that she'd expected. Look at me at verse 16. Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. When does she suddenly recognize Jesus? When he says her name. Now this explains the empty tomb, doesn't it? In a rather unexpected way, but it does explain it. The body hadn't been stolen. It had been raised. So she wipes away her tears and wraps her arms around Jesus. But his response is somewhat surprising. Look at me at verse 17. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Excuse me. It seems like Jesus is being a bit cold, doesn't it? Actually, what he's doing is he's telling her how important it is that she communicate to the disciples that he's risen and that he's about to ascend to his heavenly Father. And that is exactly what she goes on to do. But did you notice how Jesus doesn't only refer to God as his Father, but as her Father too? He says that because she, like all of Jesus' followers, has been brought into God's family through his death. Now, before we move on to the next few verses, it's worth highlighting here just how significant it is that the very first person Jesus appeared to was a woman. Now, we don't appreciate just how shocking this would have been because our views about women today are so different to those held in the first century. Back then, sadly, women were not respected and their testimony was not taken seriously. Now, why is that worth mentioning? If, hypothetically, John were making up the account of Jesus' resurrection, if he were fabricating it, it would have been insane to have chosen a woman as the very first witness. He would have totally undercut the credibility of his biography to his first readers. And why on earth would he want to do that? We have to conclude, therefore, that he's recorded a woman as a first witness because he's just recounting the story as it happened. He's simply being true to the events. So how can we be sure that Jesus rose from the dead? We can be sure because he appeared to a woman, Mary. And we can be sure because he appeared to his disciples. Our second point is the disciples saw the risen Jesus. How do you think the disciples were feeling after Jesus' death? Distraught, of course. But that's not all they were feeling. Look with me at verse 19. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." What were the disciples feeling? Fear. Why? Well, they were scared that the Jewish leaders who'd executed their Messiah was about to do the same thing, were about to do the same thing to them. Yet, we know that the disciples went on to tell others about Jesus' resurrection. So what moved them from fear to boldness? It wasn't positive thinking, practicing a bit of mindfulness, or listening to a motivational talk by Tony Robbins. It was encountering the risen Jesus, who we see in verses 21 and 22, giving them his peace and his spirit. These disciples went on to proclaim Christ's resurrection, which eventually led to their martyrdoms. Why would 11 men who were petrified of the Jewish religious leaders who'd killed their Messiah, want to go on to tell others about a resurrection that never happened? Why on earth would they have made up the resurrection story if it would only put them even more firmly in the crosshairs of the Jewish leaders they so feared? The fact that the disciples were willing to die for speaking of Jesus' resurrection rather than deny it and thereby save their own skin points to the fact that Jesus really rose from the dead. About a year ago, I was having a chat with a young man who's not a Christian. And I was telling him about the disciples' willingness to die for Jesus. And he said that it wasn't their willingness to die for Jesus wasn't actually very different from, say, an ISIS fighter's willingness to die for Allah. And that therefore we shouldn't read much into the disciples' martyrdoms. Here's the thing though. An ISIS fighter seeks to kill himself along with quote-unquote infidels in the hope that he will get into paradise. He's selfish. But the disciples were willing to become martyrs so that others might enter paradise through hearing about the risen Lord Jesus. They were not selfish, but selfless. And an ISIS martyr is dying for something he has no proof of. He dies hoping that what his beloved prophet taught 1400 years ago is true. The disciples, however, were willing to die based on events that they had witnessed with their very own eyes. They didn't go on to die for something that they had read about in a book. They went on to die for something that they had witnessed firsthand. Do you see how comparing the martyrdoms of the disciples and ISIS fighters is like comparing apples and oranges? Now, I want to return to the objection that Mary and the disciples, the person that they saw, wasn't really Jesus. Is it possible that Mary and the disciples saw Jesus' doppelganger and mistook him for Jesus? Look with me at verse 20. After Jesus said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. If this was Jesus' stunt double, he's sure gone through a lot of pain to try and con Jesus' mates, hasn't he? By hammering nails into his hands and piercing a spear into his side. He certainly doesn't lack determination, right? Do we see how this just cannot be a lookalike? This isn't a long-lost identical twin brother of Jesus. This is the Christ. Not only do the disciples recognize him because they'd spent 3 years on the road with him, but they can confirm it's him because of the fresh wounds from his crucifixion. There's no doubting who this is. But perhaps some of you are still skeptical. Maybe you identify a bit with the man we see in verse 24. Have a look down with me at verse 24. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Are you a bit like Thomas? Do you want hard evidence? I wonder if you've ever thought that the disciples were a bit naive and gullible. Thomas was neither. Now, we might sometimes catch ourselves looking down our noses at the disciples because we think we know so much more than they did with the advances in science and so on. And look, sure, there are many things we know today that they didn't know in the first century. But there are also many things that they did know. One of them being, as I said earlier, that dead people stay dead. That's hardly something we've discovered in the last 20 years. So when Thomas heard his friends say that Jesus had risen, it was hard for him to believe. Their word wasn't enough for him. He had to see Jesus with his own eyes. Do you feel like you would have to see Jesus as well with your own eyes in order to believe? Look with me at verse 26. A week later, Jesus' disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Thomas believed because he saw Jesus. But Jesus says that we can believe without seeing him. And we can believe because the disciples' witness has been recorded and preserved for us. The evidence for Jesus' resurrection is so compelling that even an Orthodox Jew and biblical scholar by the name of Pincus Lapide admitted the following: I accept the resurrection of Easter Sunday not as an invention of the community of disciples, but as a historical event. Now bear in mind that those words were written by an Orthodox Jew, a man who denied that Jesus was the Messiah. Now how he could believe that Jesus was not the Messiah, yet believe that he rose physically from the dead, is a whole nother issue. But we have to admit that it is astounding that such a well-respected non-Christian scholar would make that concession. He's essentially saying, look, there's so much evidence for the resurrection that we cannot but conclude that it happened. You see, unlike Thomas, we can't see to believe. But we can believe without seeing. Now imagine that we did have to see the risen Jesus in order to believe in him. We'd be stuffed because we were born 2,000 years too late. If you're not believing in Jesus, heed his words. Stop doubting and believe. How much more evidence do you need? These verses are showing us that we have all the evidence we require. Have a look with me at verse 30. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. We can be certain that Jesus rose from the dead because it's been recorded for us. Mary saw him and the disciples saw him. Believing in Jesus isn't blind faith. It's evidence-based faith. So believing in Jesus' resurrection isn't wishful thinking. If you're not a Christian and you've joined in this evening, we're so glad you have. I really hope that you will heed Jesus' call to believe in him. He offers you life and salvation from the judgment that every single one of us deserves. If you're a Christian, I hope that this passage has renewed your confidence in Jesus' resurrection. Verse 31 says that if we believe in him, we have life. When we turn on the news, nowadays, all we hear about is death, isn't it? Are we worried? If we are, it's understandable. But if we're trusting in Jesus, even if the coronavirus should take this present body's life away, it cannot take our eternal life away. It cannot stop us from rising to eternal life with Jesus. Keep believing in him, and like him, you will be resurrected. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for preserving the witness of the disciples for us. Thank you that we have this account, that we can know for sure that Jesus really rose from the dead. What great news that is for us, that Jesus conquered the grave, and that if we believe in him, we too will be resurrected. We will have life beyond the grave with him.
But what a joyful picture that is, Father. And we cannot wait to be with Jesus forever. Thank you for such a wonderful Savior. Thank you for showing us your power to rise the dead. Thank you for the future we can have because of him. Amen.
Well, that brings us to the end of our time together this Resurrection Sunday. Just a reminder that you are very welcome to get in touch with us if you have any questions about anything you've heard this evening or on any of our videos. We'd love to hear from you and have a chance to explain more about the church family and what we believe and about the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Do drop us a line wherever you're watching this video, send us a message or pop onto our website christchurchbanstead.org and you can leave us a message there as well. Let us close with a prayer. These things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Father, this Easter we thank you for true hope and true life found in Jesus. And Lord, we commit one another to your care, and we ask that in the days that lie ahead, the risen, reigning Jesus would become more and more real to us. For we pray this in his name. Amen. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you again soon. Bye for now.